Welcome, children, to the Silver Scream Fiends podcast. Prepare yourself for some killer kino, some spooky cinema, and plenty of tales of terror. Relax, grab a drink, make yourself at home, and listen to another evil episode. And hopefully, you'll make it out alive.
Welcome back to the Silver Scream Fiends podcast. I'm your host, Sam.
And I'm Blake.
Do not scare the audience like that. And in this week's turmoil, I spilled an entire cup of gamer juice before we went live.
Hell yeah.
So now my keyboard's sticky.
You got that gamer gunk on it.
But you know what's not sticky? Are the Elm Street movies. Well, sometimes
Frederick.
Frederick.
Yeah, they could be cut. Actually, you know what? They're pretty sticky.
Frederick J. Krueger.
As a franchise, pretty sticky overall. So yeah, you know, that was wrong.
That's a fair point. Honestly, yeah. We'll refund you. Sorry. But yeah, for our final episode of the Scream block, we're going to not talk about Scream because we did that last year, but we're going to talk about the entire Elm Street franchise, and yes, that includes the god-awful remake.
Yep.
But we start off with a pretty solid film, I would say. I just want to note that Freddy Krueger, you know, after going through several horror franchises and the abundance of other movies I've watched, I think Freddy Krueger has to be, like, one of the most brilliantly written villains I've ever seen in horror. You know? It's like, Freddy's been so ingrained in society since the 80s that, like, it almost is that weird mentality of, like, someone walking into a Hot Topic and just seeing, like, the horror icon shirts. Like, yeah, we know about, but once you actually watch the movies, because I've only seen, like, two of them, once you actually sit down and watch them, you're like, wow, like, what? I already knew Wes Craven was a fucking genius, but, like, this is just, man. Because I'll say that out of all the franchises, too, the credit I'll give to this one is that most others have a lot of weak entries, and even if there are weaker ones here, I could confidently say I could rewatch all these movies and, like, not be disgusted.
Yeah, I would say the worst Elm Street movie is much better than the worst Halloween movie.
Right. Yeah, it's like night and day. So yeah,
which is
Halloween Ends, yeah. But yeah, so the first movie, I would say that, you know, in a lot of franchises, it's kind of hard to have, like, that proper exposition. And in this one, Freddy is played more seriously, whereas the rest of the series is notorious for how ridiculous it becomes with its comedic elements. And I know that Craven, when he was conceptualizing Freddy, originally wanted the character to be very dark, like, more so than in this movie. But that will tie into a point I will bring up in the remake way later. So we'll just stick to this for now. But yeah, so we have this new little movie called A Nightmare on Elm Street, which brings a pretty cool twist to the slasher genre, because most of the time, you know, conventional slasher is just, like, maniac on the run who usually doesn't really speak. He speaks in grunts, and then he just carries around, like, a big knife and just kills people one by one. In this, it's like Craven actually did something really creative and brought, like, these horrific nightmare elements into it, you know? And
yeah,
I appreciate that, because for the time it was like, oh, that's pretty fucking cool.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't confidently say that Freddy is the first, but Freddy is probably the biggest slasher villain that right out of the gate is, like, supernatural, which is really cool. Like, Michael, Jason, they all kind of start out grounded in reality, like serial killer kind of stuff. Freddy, like, right out the gate is like a demon supernatural kind of character, which is really cool.
Yeah, yeah, I do appreciate that, too. And that's, like, and it's important, especially in a movie where it's, like, centralized on dreams, right? It's like you need that fantastical element. And Which why the remake sucked. Okay, anyway, so we have this group of kids, Nancy, Tina, Rod, and Glenn. Which is, it's funny because in the beginning of the movie, I remember thinking this, they almost set it up as if Tina is going to be the lead. Like they're all at this, I forget whose house it is, but like trying to have like a little sleepover, and Tina ends up just getting murked.
which obviously we learn once Scream comes out is like kind of a Wes Craven thing. It's like the misdirect of who the main character is going to be.
Yes.
This is like the first time that we see that.
Yeah, that, exactly. Yeah. So she gets murdered by Freddy while Rod is in the room, and he freaks the fuck out, and obviously it doesn't look good for him, so he goes into hiding. I mean, and that's one thing I really love. Like, one of my favorite tropes in these like 80s horror movies is like, not even 80s, but mostly 80s, it's like some supernatural being kills someone while someone else is in the room. They get blamed for it, and they either have to get locked up in a psychiatric ward, or they go to prison, or they end up dying. I love that. I think that's so, because it's like, it's an added element, right? It's like, not only do you see like your best friend or your girlfriend or boyfriend die in front of you, but then it's like you're getting blamed for it. I think it's right. Like that extra element of terror.
Yeah, well, because especially in a supernatural case, it's like, how do you explain yourself without sounding completely insane?
Right. It's
so
like,
it's like to put yourself in that scenario, you realize how like scary it is.
Yeah, it's like the Chucky movies. It's like, oh, a doll killed your friend. Like, no,
it right. didn't.
So he gets caught. Brought in by Nancy's father, who is played by the brilliant John Saxon. I think he does a great job. He's a cop. And of course, we have the typical 80s horror trope as well of the adult figure not believing a teen when they're saying they're being stalked, which is like what I was adding to with that.
Which also, rest in peace to him. He died in 2020. So
yeah.
Shout out to him. Shout out to John Saxon.
He didn't get his lobster.com order in time, and unfortunately, rest in peace, big guy. So Nancy at this point is now getting targeted, and she attempts to stay awake throughout the movie by just consuming as much caffeine as she can before she ODs. meanwhile, what I really like, which doesn't seem like a really creative kill, but Rod in the jail cell, when he gets hanged by the blanket, I actually thought that was a pretty cool practical effect.
I mean, this movie's loaded with great, the whole franchise is loaded with insane practical effects that I'm sure we'll talk about each one as we're going through it, but yeah, the effects in these movies are absolutely insane.
Yeah, I mean, one of my favorite kills in the entire series is in this movie, where Glenn, played by a very babyface Johnny Depp.
I think this was his first movie, or one of his first
this
movies.
This was one of his earliest roles. And no one knew he would go on to be no one of merit, just in the biggest lawsuit ever.
To be Grindelwald,
yeah.
Beloved character Grindelwald. Beloved character Rango.
Yeah. Oh, right. Yes. Or Mordecai.
Great movie. Great movie.
Yeah. Right. Fuck yeah. But him getting like sucked into the bed by Freddy, and then the blood is just spurting out of the ceiling, is one of the coolest things I've ever seen.
Yeah, and I believe they did that scene. The blood, they did it like upside down. Like, I think they filmed it like the room is upside down, and they were pouring the blood out of it, and then obviously flipped it around, because they couldn't like shoot blood at that rate from like any kind of cannon or whatever. So yeah, I'm pretty sure they filmed that scene upside down, which is really cool.
Yeah, I was actually wondering about that, but I guess that really is like the only way they could have done it, because like the amount of blood
shot
out, it was too much. And another thing I like too with this movie is it is very, well, of course, because it's dream-centric, but it's very realistic in the way it's portraying dreams, because it's like, like locations will switch up at random, and then it, like, you kind of question your sanity. I know later in the series it gets like even more ludicrous, but like in this one it felt more so like, oh, it's an actual dream, like between you passing out and what's going on to the moment of realization right before you're waking up. And Nancy and Heather Langenkamp, who does a fucking amazing job, she just this trauma that she's going through, and especially like when she's doing that sleep study in the hospital, and I think one of my favorite parts is like the whole the people not believing her thing is when she pulls Freddy's hat out from the dream in the hospital, and they're still like, nope. But then we realize Nancy's mom obviously is hiding something. So
yeah.
But I always found that funny. Is like, nope. Oh, just dirty old man hat ended up in bed. I guess you're the crazy one.
Also, another scene that I wanted to touch on is the alleyway sequence where Freddy stretches his arms out and like scratches the sides of the alleyway when he's chasing Tina.
That's right.
Because that, from what I've read, I read this book called Shock Value that is like one of my favorite books about horror movies. It's basically each chapter is just about the complete like process of making a classic horror movie. And they, I don't remember if they do a full chapter on Nightmare on Elm Street, but they cover Wes Craven. And that scene was kind of like where the idea for the movie came from. It was basically like Wes Craven, when he was a kid, lived in an apartment building, and he looked out his window one night, and there was like, I don't know if it was like a drunk guy or some, there was a guy standing in like the alleyway outside of his apartment building, and he looked down at him, and the guy like made eye contact with him, and it like it scared the shit out of baby Wes Craven. And
oh God.
That kind of like, and apparently he was wearing a hat like Freddy's hat. So that was kind of like where the idea for Freddy came from, was like that guy in an alleyway. And so that scene is a pretty direct reflection of the like original inspiration for the movie, which is really cool.
I had no idea. That's very, is it life or art that is the imitation?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's, ooh. That would freak me out as a kid.
Yeah, it's a crazy story.
Yeah. Yeah, well, Wes, yeah, and it's funny too, because they kind of like, we'll get to it, but his new Nightmare movie, it's kind of like, they almost allude to that. And I think like through all of his works, there must have just been so many things he like experienced, because a lot of them like, they're so wrapped in like this meta formula that he's composed. It's almost like
he's almost like Stephen King, where he has this like universe surrounding him and all of his works.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, it's such a good first entry into a series. It does so many things right. It's fun. It's gory. It's campy. Freddy is, of course, I like the comedic elements of Freddy, but he's more serious in this one. And he's also a much more mysterious figure. Like, most shots of him is kind of obscured by silhouette, and he's like more sinister. But it's not like grounded. It's like they found like a good balance, I think. But yeah, no, there are times like I was legit, I would say out of all of the movies, this one, like, I wouldn't say I was ever scared, but this one definitely creeped me a little. Like,
yeah, this is the one that I can see how it was scary when it came out, even though today, like, it looks a little dated, but it's, I can watch it and be like, okay, like, this would probably freak me out too if I saw it in, you know, 84 or whenever it was that came out. And yeah, just like the idea of a killer that attacks you in your dreams, like with Michael or Jason or whatever, like there's always the feeling like, well, I could just run away. Like I could get in a car and run away and like he would never get me. But with Freddy, your brain is where he comes for you. So there's really no escape. And you need to sleep eventually. So you can't really run from Freddy, which makes him really scary.
Can't run from Fred, which, by the way, this is the only entry that he is called Fred Krueger.
Yeah.
And I'm so glad they did not stick with that.
Yeah.
Because it's funny because you hear Freddy and you almost think like that's not really an intimidating name, but it works. It somehow works. Like, Fred just doesn't... Fred is like my fucking clerk at my grocery store. Like,
well, it's funny if you think about it. Like, all of the big slashers, Jason, Michael, Fred,
are just
Charles. Names. Like, it's just normal white guy names.
I know, because the white man is the most terrifying villain of all.
True, okay, but that's a whole different podcast.
That's a whole different podcast. So anyway, after Johnny Depp gets completely fucking murked, Nancy booby traps her entire house in an effort to like pull him from the dreams. And man, I'll say, like, the whole part where her father is like at the house across the street investigating the Glenn death, and then Nancy like going toe to toe with Freddy, that encounter was cool. But man, it infuriated me that In this, especially where the movie ends up, right? Like, all these kids are dying. Nancy's like confiding in her father, like, listen, please, I'm gonna try to pull this psycho out of the dream. Like, even if you don't believe me, please be the one to arrest this motherfucker. He's like, oh yeah, no problem. And then he just turns to his lackey and he's like, hey, can you check up on my daughter in 10 minutes? Like, dude, she's screaming bloody murder for you to help her. Like, you're not gonna fucking help her. Like, part just infuriates me.
Yeah, some suspension of disbelief with how bad of a father he is.
Yeah, seriously, it's like, it doesn't matter if you don't believe her. Like, if she's that passionate and insistent, maybe listen.
Yeah.
But yeah, I thought the final confrontation was pretty fun. And then he finally ends up back at the house. He gains his senses and she ignores him. Which, another thing I really like with Freddy is like that his kryptonite is like not acknowledging him or forgetting about him. I thought that was cool. Yeah. And especially it's something that is much more touched upon later in the films, like especially Freddy versus Jason. But in this one, it's like they kind of set that in stone, like they put a little thing in the back of your brain to remember that that's how you can potentially get rid of him, at least for the time being. I love the, oh my god, Nancy's mother like getting fucking consumed. And you know what, the whole aftermath of that, of like the father, just his face was so like, we'll never speak of this again. Like, don't ever. It wasn't even like, there was no like outcry. It was just like, well, I guess she's gone now.
Very deep character.
Yeah, very deep character. Yeah, but I fucking really loved it because I've only seen it like once so many years ago that I didn't even the only thing I remembered is Glenn dying in the bed. Like, that's really it was a treat to be able to rewatch this because I was like, there's so many movies that end up on my backlog, but this I made like a conscious effort to, like, this was my first movie of this month because we do our horror movie challenges. This was the first movie I chose because I was like, I was so fucking excited to see like the origin of it all.
Yeah.
And then
it holds up. It's still
oh yeah,
easily one of the better entries in the franchise. Definitely top three, if not one, you know?
Yeah, oh absolutely. Yeah. I would say, like, me personally, Dream Warriors beats it, and it's only by a margin. Like, it's not it's nothing crazy, but it's so strong. It is very strong foundation, which then leads us into part two, which is one of the most divisive films as far as I know, because what they decided to do is it only being the second movie in the franchise took a drastically different turn and had Freddy like control this kid, Jesse, who his family just moves into the house, the original Elm Street house from the first movie. And Jesse finds out with his girlfriend that this girl Nancy lived there because her diary was in the closet, which, speaking of which, the overtones of this movie.
Yeah, I was going to say, have you seen that documentary that came out of all about this movie?
So I have not, but it's on my list. Yeah.
It's very good. Yeah. I highly recommend it. It basically goes into the overtones of the movie, which people interpreted as being very much like a story about being gay in the early 80s. And it's really, I mean, once you watch it, you're like, there's no way this wasn't intentional. Like, it's not possible because it's so overt once it's like pointed out to you. And it's great. It's a really interesting story. And it's a really like fascinating take on Freddy. And it's interesting that it was only the second movie. It's not like late in the franchise we're getting into this like deeper nuanced stuff about Freddy. This is part two, which is crazy.
Yeah, I will say the first time I watched this, I knew going into it that there was kind of this like a homosexual subplot, and I was like kind of looking out for it, and there were probably parts of it that I could parse, like when he sleepwalks and he goes to that bar. Yeah, a lot of people say it's a gay bar. I wasn't quite sure. And then he sees his fucking teacher there from high school. He's like, go do laps in the gym. So he goes back to the gym, and then like his coach gets dragged into the showers and starts getting spanked. And I'm like, wait, there might be something here.
Also unrelated to that, but I wanted to mention one of my favorite aspects of this movie is the scene where his like younger sister is eating breakfast and she puts on like the little plastic nails. The cereal that she's eating is called Fu Man Chews, like chew. That's the cereal that she's eating, which I think is so fucking funny.
Oh man, that's great. Fu Man Chews. Yeah, that would go over well today. So yeah, so as the movie goes on, he gradually gets possessed by Freddy, which I think I know a lot of people. I wouldn't say I loved or hated this movie, but a lot of people argue that the whole Freddy controlling him thing was kind of stupid. I thought it was pretty cool for them to try something like that, especially so early on in the series.
It's interesting that they don't really go back to that much. Later in the series, the like possession thing, maybe like here and there they like hint at it, but like it's the whole focus of this movie, and it's kind of ignored in later entries in favor of fun like campy Freddy deaths. You know, this one's a little bit more, I would say it's a pretty serious entry in a franchise that becomes pretty campy later on. Which again, it's a follow-up to the first one, which is a very serious take. So it's interesting. It's a very different entry in the franchise that, I can see why it's divisive. I like it. And I think that the gay like undertone and subplot makes it better, because I think it's a smarter movie than people maybe realize that it is because of that. So it's good. It's definitely an outlier as far as the rest of the franchise.
Yeah, and to add to that, it gets like even more intentional with its motivation and themes, because like then they fast forward to the party that I believe it's at his girlfriend's house, and you know, she's trying to become intimate with him, but he has like so much on his mind with Freddy and everything. He like freaks out. He leaves that little cabin and he goes finds his friend Ron. He's like, dude, you gotta help me. You gotta come watch me. Like, don't let me fall asleep. And Ron says something like, why don't you ask your girlfriend to do this? And that's when it kind of clicked in my head. Like, oh, is this like him confronting his feeling? Like so yeah, it is a smart movie in that sense.
Yeah. It's you don't see Freddy as metaphor ever again in the franchise. And maybe it's because when this movie came out, I don't know if it was like well received or not. I'm not 100% sure. I know it wasn't like a Halloween 3 situation where people like hated it, but I don't know how well received it was, because obviously for part 3 they go in a totally different direction. So I don't really know.
Yeah, I have no idea how any of these were received, except the remake. Because no one should ever watch it.
But anyway, how I receive it.
Yeah. But yeah, like going into like that next scene of fucking Ron dying and Freddy ripping through Jesse's chest and going into the party. That's my favorite scene, is Freddy just like aimlessly slashing people around this fucking backyard. And the kid, oh my God, the kid trying to reason with him cracks me up. It's like, listen,
even
man.
That too. That's like Freddy outside of the dream realm. I don't know if we get that again either, which is interesting.
Yeah, it's because the last, like, before Freddy vs. Jason, those last few films, like, his focus is to exit that world, but there's so many, like, barriers. But, yeah, he legit pops out of Jesse's chest and just, he's like, huh, I'm Freddy.
And it's just there. He's just here.
I'm here, and then just, like, walks through a fence. But that whole scene is wonderful. And then it gets, like, very strange because Jesse's girlfriend, like, somehow knows the power plant that Freddy used to work at. And then there's, like, those weird dogs with, like, the doll faces. That was, like, very fucking weird. and then Freddy's killed off, and then you see him in control of the school bus at the end. That I thought that was cool.
The intro, too, with the school bus is cool.
Yeah, because it's like, oh, that's him. That's cool. It's like, that's something I caught. I was like, huh, that's gonna be something. because there's a lot of things that seem unintentional but are laid out for a reason, and the bus is one of them. And especially like the personalities of the kids, which becomes very abundant actually even in the next installment, like whenever you know the personality of each kid, you could kind of have a good idea of how they're going to die. Cause like,
yeah, it always comes back.
Yeah. That's how like Freddy gets them. But speaking of which, now we enter my favorite, which is Dream Warriors.
Also my favorite.
I definitely think it's the best one in the series.
I think it's the one that like, if you never watched a Nightmare on Elm Street movie before and you're like, I don't want to start with the first one, what do I start with? I would say watch Dream Warriors. You get everything that you want out of a Freddy movie with Dream Warriors.
Yeah, and especially because all the kids in this one actually have the most personality of like
the whole it's basically series. This movie's basically like Freddy versus like the X-Men.
I love how diverse it is. You know, you have this like, you have a handicapped nerd who wants to be like a D&D master,
a wizard master.
Yeah, a wizard master.
I love that part of the movie.
Yeah, you have like this edgelord guy named Philip who's just like, oh fuck the world. You have just such a creative cast of people, and Nancy's back, which I really appreciate. It was cool seeing Heather again.
It was a good way to bring her back too.
Yeah.
A smart way to do it. Cause she's really not the main character, but it's nice that she's like involved in the story still.
Yeah. Cause the new lead in this is a girl named Kristen who's played by Patricia Arquette. And what's really cool is they establish her as someone who has the power to pull other people into her dreams. So if Freddy is like right there, she's like, oh no, motherfucker, and then tries to pull someone. And then Nancy kind of finds this kinship with her and realizes that she has this power. And she tries to convince the head of, I don't know exactly what you call him. I guess he's a psychiatrist because they're like in a ward, but he.
Yeah, I think so.
She's trying to like convince him to. You know, I always forget the fucking name of the drug. Is it Halcyon?
No,
it's not Halcyon. It's
Hypno something? Hypnosil? Is that it?
That might be it. Yeah. So it's a drug to like keep them awake, essentially. And I like that Nancy kind of speaks from that place of trauma and a bunch of the movies, like trying to convince everyone to just like let go. And
it's Hypnosil. I looked it up. Yeah
I was kind of hoping
it comes back in Freddy versus Jason. It comes back.
Yes, I do remember that. I was kind of hoping it was Hypnotoad because that was but I think one thing that's really interesting about this movie is that in a way it has an oddly wholesome message, because in this film, mm-hmm. all the kids have these dreams, you know, like literally and metaphorically, and they like each one of them wants to achieve something, like the nerd who cannot walk, you know, he wants to be a wizard master, and once they enter the dream, like once they all get hypnotized and they enter the state of slumber in the dream, like each of them can do what they've wanted to do in real life, yeah. in their dreams. So,
and they like look the way they want to look too.
Yeah, so it's like oddly wholesome for a movie about child murder.
Yeah, it's funny because this entry is almost like a step away from horror and a step towards like dark fantasy, kind of. Because it's very much like a fantasy movie.
Yeah. No, honestly, I didn't really think of that, but that, yeah, especially the wizard shit.
Yeah, the wizard master.
But man. But
yeah, it's very like comic booky. It's great.
But man, some of the kills in this movie are so good. Like the girl Jennifer who tries to keep herself up by watching TV, and she fucking,
oh yeah, that's the one of the most classic prime time
bitch. Yeah, just fucking, yeah, that her head in the TV, I was like, girl mood, that's what's up. But that is fucking, that's great. And also, yeah. Philip getting like puppeteered with his veins and shit.
Yeah, that sequence is really cool. And the stop motion little Freddy puppet.
Yes. Oh my God. Yeah. This one was just one of the more creative ones. It was.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's, I just lost my train of thought. What was I about to say? this one has the perfect balance, I think, of like Freddy, like wisecracking Freddy and Freddy as like a threat. Because obviously, yes. as the franchise goes on, he gets cornier and cornier, which is not necessarily a bad thing. It's just, I think this one is the perfect balance of funny Freddy and scary Freddy.
I 100% agree. And especially works given like the subject matter of the story, because this one definitely deals with more trauma, because you not only have all these patients who are trying to just live a normal life and their dreams are haunted and no one believes them, but then you also have Nancy, who's lived through this trauma, trying to help the others through it. So it's almost it's almost, again, in a wholesome way, like bringing everyone together. There's so much, and they kind of go a little bit more into Freddy's past. Like with each movie, they dive a little bit more into his past, which I mm-hmm. really like. Like you find out he had this mother who, like, you know, horrible shit happened to her.
What were you gonna say?
I was just gonna say, like, funny side note, I love that like they just threw Lawrence Fishburne in this movie.
That I was literally about to say. Also, did you notice that Lawrence Fishburne's in this?
Yeah.
Also, in the opening credits, he is credited as Larry Fishburne.
I did not realize that.
Yeah, which is kind of funny. Obviously, he decided later on to go by Lawrence. But yeah, he's like the orderly in this movie, which also must have been one of his early roles, too.
Yeah, because this was 85, right?
87, actually.
Oh, 87. Okay. So it was very nice seeing him.
Yeah, it's a funny addition.
In each movie they like try to kill Freddy in a different way. So they try to give him like this proper burial, and Nancy's father comes back, which I thought is cool, and the whole like fucking like battle between him and the fucking the Freddy bones. Oh my God.
Yeah.
So silly. Yep. It was good. It was almost like Army of Darkness shit.
Yeah, again, it's like that dark fantasy. It's kind of like the Jason Mummy or something. Argonauts,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he eventually does get buried and he throws holy water on him. But yeah, I just very quickly wanted to backtrack and talk about that scene where the nerd gets confronted by Freddy and he turns into the Wizard Master.
Yeah, I am the Wizard Master.
He can shoot laser beams from his fingers and for no reason has a Dracula cape, which is hysterical.
It is very funny. And like the game, the like Dungeons and Dragons knockoff that he plays is called Wizard Master because obviously they didn't want to use the copyrighted material. So yeah, it's just so funny, right. Wizard Master.
Right. Yeah. So this, and then this he just one, gets, yeah.
Then he just gets washed by Freddy.
Yeah. So this one is a great, great entry. I like you said earlier, if you were gonna recommend one to someone who just didn't want to watch the first one for whatever reason, this is the one you should watch.
It just has everything, in my opinion, that you would want out of a Nightmare on Elm Street movie.
Yeah. What doesn't, though, really for me is the next one, which is the Dream Master.
I think in general the franchise goes a little downhill after part three. Not again, it's still like the worst Freddy movie is still better than the worst like Halloween movie, but still.
Yeah, I would say this one honestly might have been the most forgettable to me. I don't I think it's fine, but they did so many things that I didn't really like care for, like them basically killing off the remaining cast of Dream Warriors in the beginning of this.
Yeah, one, I hate like, when movies do that.
I was like, that's kind of that stupid. But and also in this movie, this is where things begin to not make as much sense as far as like the rules they establish between the real world and the dream world. And like Freddy decides, because the whole point is Freddy is seeking revenge on Elm Street and anyone associated with it because of what happened to him, which we'll get into a little later. But then he just starts going off killing random people. And it's like, I get it, like it's still a slasher, but it was just interesting how they like did so many like different things with this one. I was like, like, I don't know. But so you have this girl, Alice, who can actually, interestingly, can gain powers from people who die. Like, so the people, like the new cast in this movie, as they get killed off one by one, like, for example, there's that kid who's like a karate champ. And when he dies, she actually becomes like this martial arts master and starts kicking around Freddy. So I thought that was kind of interesting. I wouldn't say it was enough for me to like really love the movie, but it was a cool twist, I thought.
It's interesting because Dream Warriors came out 2 years after Freddy's Revenge. This one came out the next year, so I wonder if maybe it was a little bit more like rushed in the production because Dream Warriors did so well. I could be completely making that up. I have no evidence to back that up, but it coming out like the next year, whereas Dream Warriors took 2 years to make, I wonder if there's a connection there.
Yeah, I think that you might be onto something because it does seem like it was a bit rushed because of the things they changed, and there wasn't a whole lot of action in this one. I mean, it was all right, but it didn't really like satiate my taste for Freddy. I did think that this was one of the coolest Freddy deaths of like the souls leaving his body. I thought the effects were fucking great for that, but yeah, I don't know, like this was kind of a forgettable one for me. I don't really know what else to even say about it.
Yeah, I would agree. Is this the one where he has like the souls in his chest, right?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, I remember I mentioned that because they have that at the Museum of the Moving Image in Queens, which I went to in college like a long time ago, and they have that prop piece of the chest with all the souls coming out of it.
That's fucking cool.
Which is pretty cool to see. Yeah.
And I guess I would say like a cool element of that is with every movie they try to introduce like a new fantastical element to the character, and with this one you find out like he's using the souls, like the souls are his life force, and So I thought, yeah, I thought that death was cool. But other than that, it was, it would probably be the last one I run to rewatch.
Yeah, it's watchable, but it's not memorable.
Exactly. Dream Child, on the other hand, I thought was definitely better. I thought
it's much crazier too.
Yeah,
like right out of the gate, it's a pretty crazy movie.
Yeah. So Alice is back, along with Dan, and they begin the movie in the most lame softcore porn scene I've ever witnessed.
Yeah. Bizarre opening credits.
Very bizarre. And then you see this really like hellish pregnancy.
I was gonna say it's funny because in part three they mention like that Freddy's like creation is from like his mother, who was a nun, being like raped by like 70 something like lunatics or whatever, and you're like, wow, that's crazy, that's fucked up. And then they're like, you know what, let's show that in this one.
Yeah,
not graphically show it, but like it's funny how they go back to that and are like, let's show what that looks like.
Yeah, and they show like baby Freddy just like right in the mall. It's like, oh god, I'm like, I know where this is going. And so he tries to use Alice's unborn child, their dreams to get to people in the real world, which like now even makes littler sense in how he's able to use his power. But like, I think that's really fucking cool.
Freddy, if you were to do like a Dungeons and Dragons scenario based on Nightmare on Elm Street, it would be very difficult to figure out the rules for Freddy because they're just different every movie.
I know. At this point, I don't question it, but it's just like, it's just funny to note it because it's like, what are you doing?
Yeah. And I get a lot of the times they're bending it for the sake of including cool kills and like just moving the story forward. So that's not a criticism. It's just a funny observation is that every movie there's just like new rules.
Definitely not bashing on it. But speaking of the kills in this one, I think they're probably the most predictable. Like there's that kid Mark who's like the comic book artist, and it's like, okay, he's getting like either sucked into a comic book or he's getting penciled to death or something. the cast in this one, I definitely cared, I guess like a little bit more about, but it still didn't really like resonate that well with me. I will say though, Greta, the one like apathetic girl, her death was great. Her at the fucking dinner table, and she gets, and she gets force fed. Bon appetit, bitch. Is probably again, my favorite.
This is like favorite Freddy line. We're at full on corny Freddy at this point in the franchise. Again, not a criticism, just an observation.
Yeah, like her getting force fed and her cheeks being expanded, and she just fucking dies.
So gross.
and like the stop motion fridge food, and it's full on camp now. And you get like even more backstory here, and Alice realizes that like, oh, probably the only way to like get rid of him and make sure my baby's okay is to like tell the mother to fuck off and lay to rest. That whole final showdown I thought was really, really cool. Cause like a little bit before that, they'll show Alice's unborn child and like how Freddy's trying to get to him, and I thought the way they did that was pretty smart, and him like trying to be pulled in, and then like when he actually resists Freddy, I thought was really fucking cool. Like the way he like extends out his hands, and it's so impressive to me how Craven built like this grandiose world, and like all the set designs are really cool. This is one of my favorite sets in the movies.
Agreed.
It's definitely,
you can see that, you could see the budget going up and up and up in each movie, you know, which it reflects very much in the sets and in the kills and in the like props and stuff. You see that this movie, when it came out, was huge.
Yes, I think that it's very impressive what they did. I don't know what the budget was, but yeah, I give props to the series for being able to like actually convince you that you're in this like hellish nightmare world. But yeah, I thought, yeah, that final showdown was cool. Definitely one of the better. Dream Child, I would say, I don't know, like, I'd probably have to sit down and do my complete ranking, but I think you'd probably be like upper middle.
Yeah, okay, like, it's a good upper middle entry. I would agree.
Yeah. Then we have Freddy's Dead, where it
the is final night,
absolutely the silliest movie ever. Like, there is not a sillier horror movie that still tries to be serious.
We're in full campy Freddy at this point.
Like it opens with that kid, the name escapes me, he's on a plane and he slips into a dream and Freddy's flying outside the plane.
Yeah, it's the Wicked Witch.
He's like the Wicked Witch.
It's
I'm like, oh, this is gonna be a goofy ass ride. And then he gets amnesia, ends up at a homeless shelter. You meet the rest of the cast there. Again, they set up their personalities for future kills. And kind of the new lead here is Maggie, who runs the shelter, who you eventually find out is Freddy's daughter. Which I thought was a fun twist. Because like you start to learn more and more about Freddy, but it's not till this one where you're like, oh, like he had an actual fucking life, right? Like he killed his wife and his daughter was like forced to remain silent and she was traumatized. And I thought that was really fun to show that. And then like, again, they're just reinventing Freddy, and now like he has these weird sperm souls that like infected him. it almost in a way seems like they were adding this cult-like element in a way, like because of the way that the souls interacted with him. It's kind of hard to explain. But another fun fact is this film was shot in 3D, so you can.
I didn't know that.
So the DVD actually, the old DVD comes with a pair of 3D glasses, but I don't think it looks very good.
Does anything look good in the blue and red 3D? Yeah,
but it's mostly like those soul sucker things, like you could see like how. I will say, like, as great as the series effects are, like, the CGI of those souls, especially at the end, is hysterical.
Yeah.
It's bad. Again, like, the kills in this one were pretty fucking cool. Like, there's a deaf kid whose eardrum gets punctured.
Oh yeah, that one's like a cringing, you cringe.
Yes,
in a good way.
Because he goes to like drop a pin down the fire escape, and he's like no, and he catches it. Then the motherfucker just throws like an entire bag of pins out.
That is a really good kill.
Because now his ear is like really super sensitive, and then oh, him clawing on the fucking chalkboard and his head explodes. Oh man, that was good. I like that one.
I also do love the video game death in this one, where he gets sucked into the TV.
Yes, Breckenmeyer, who I believe his name is Spencer in the movie, is Stoner, which already is hysterical.
Also that scene starts with a Johnny Depp cameo.
Yes, he's on the TV. Yes. The TV. But this movie has very interesting cameos. Like, there's Roseanne Barr and Tom Arnold. Very good, not dated people. But Alice Cooper is Freddy's dad, which is pretty fucking cool. I like that. Weird cameos though for this movie.
Good stuff though.
Good stuff. Yeah, Breckenmeyer.
Again, I guess in theory they were like, at the time, this is going to be the last one. Let's like throw it all at the wall here and just go for it. Yeah. And they do.
Yeah, Breckenmeyer being turned into the video game is
so funny. Yeah,
is so.
And the like, scene where like the cartoon Freddy is just like kicking him is so funny.
Yes, I just love him hopping around. Yeah, that one, like, yeah, as silly as the movie was, I really appreciated that.
Yeah, like, to me, that's the most memorable part is that video game. I just think it's so funny.
100%. And it's very, like, the whole movie's so cartoony in nature. Like, there's even that scene where John, he's falling from the sky and Freddy cuts his parachute. And Freddy goes to, like, push this bed of spikes. It's literally like a Wile E. Coyote.
Yeah, cartoon. And Freddy becomes almost like Looney Tunes in this movie.
He's absolutely Looney Tunes in this movie.
Yeah.
Which is great, you know? It's fun.
Yeah, it's good.
Like, it's like you said, they figured this was going to be the final Freddy appearance. Might as well do whatever the fuck you want.
Right. Like, you could tell Robert Englund's having a lot of fun in this movie.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And then we finally have towards the end where Maggie confronts Freddy and she truly finds out her upbringing. And the battle itself is cool, but then her jamming the pipe bomb inside of him while saying Happy Father's Day and just giving him a kiss is, oh, it's brilliant.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah, and then the souls flying out just, oh, cracks me the fuck up. Yeah, this one definitely is one I will never forget. This was a fun ride. This is one I would rewatch with a bunch of friends. I'd be like, hey, let's get stoned.
Yeah, this is a good party movie. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, yeah, dude, and oh my god, and then the rest in peace at the end with his picture, like, from start to finish, this is just a cartoon. It's
very self-aware at this point.
It's so good.
In a good way.
Yeah, I loved it. It was great. Yeah, so then the series happens to not be over because Wes Craven does what Wes Craven does best and gets real fucking meta in New Nightmare. And it's great because, like, I could definitely see this be Craven's always been meta, but this definitely seemed like the template for Scream, like, because of the way he's like, he engrosses his movies within these layers of meta. It's like, it was like the same shit as in Scream, so I was like, he probably very heavily took inspiration to do this, but
oh yeah, because he did Scream like 2 years after this, this was definitely the beginning of him toying with those like meta ideas.
Again, like with Scream and the Stab films within the universe, Craven realizes Freddy's like coming into the real world, so he has to make another Nightmare movie to contain him, and he ends up trying to rope Heather back in. Heather. I was almost gonna say Nancy, but she plays Heather. She's Heather Langenkamp, right?
Technically, yeah.
Whoever returns, like Wes plays himself, Heather plays herself, Robert Englund plays himself, which is great. I love him like coming out in the talk show dressed as Freddy, and Heather's like kind of like at odds freaked with herself. Out, yeah. Yeah. The only thing I'll say is, man, I wish that they had like a showdown between Robert and Freddy. Like,
that would be cool.
That would have been fucking cool.
Yeah, I wonder if maybe they just didn't have the means to like pull it off effectively, like special effects wise back then. Yeah. But yeah, that would have been pretty cool.
I'm honestly thinking that had to be the reason, because there's no way Wes made this movie and was like, okay, England's not going to battle himself. It had to have been limitations.
Yeah, I would think so.
But speaking of Freddy in general, I like what they did tweaking his design. Like in this, he has like a green hat. He's got like a trench coat, and his and his face and scars are like a little darker. I like
a lot scarier. Yeah, they make him a lot scarier.
He's definitely scarier, which I think makes sense because like Heather dealing with her trauma in creating the movies is kind of playing into effect. And now Freddy's targeting her son, who I thought the kid actor was fine. It's hard. Like, yeah. These movies, it's hard with child actors. Yeah,
he's the kid from Pet Sematary as well, and Kindergarten Cop.
Yeah, and it's escaping me. What is he also in? He's in something else. I can't. It's on the tip of my tongue, but I. Yeah, look this up for me because this is gonna bother.
Yeah, I'm looking. I'm trying to figure it out. His top three on IMDb are Kindergarten Cop, Pet Sematary, and a movie called Mercury Rising, which I have not seen.
Mercury Rising. No, it wasn't he. No, is it Home Alone? I'm thinking of what. He's in something else. I can't. This is the whole podcast now, by the way.
I don't know. I'm not seeing anything else. He's in Apollo 13.
Yeah, that's where I know him from, of course.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not seeing anything else.
All right. Yeah, I mean, he did a fine job. Yeah. But I did like Freddie basically just going through her family. Like, she kills off her husband, who is a special effects artist, who is working on the Nightmare reboot. He fashions a cougar claw, which is actually how the movie opens. Heather is we're all over the place. Heather's having a nightmare where they're on the set of a Nightmare movie. And the Kruger Claws get a life of their own and start killing the cast and crew. But then he ends up dying in real life in one of the most realistic scenes ever, which everyone out there has been tired while driving a car. So him driving the car and like nodding and opening the window for air, I was like, that's me all the time. but yeah,
there I am.
But that was great. Like the claw coming out and like, kind of like tickling his sack. I was like, oh man.
This one definitely, they went back to like the first movie as far as trying to make Freddy scary.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of corny Freddy in this one.
Well, yeah, because, and I it's obviously intentional, right? Because Heather's dealing with very real trauma. Like it's very grounded in reality. And I think that he really, Wes just was such a fucking genius. Like, he's so many.
Yeah, I mean, this movie is so. Yeah. It's also just so ahead of its time. Like, this was 1994. Obviously, he would go on to make Scream, which kind of, in many ways, like, invented the meta horror thing. But this is like, this goes even meta beyond Scream, I feel like. Because Scream is meta, but it's creating its own, like, lore. Whereas, like, this is technically a Nightmare on Elm Street movie, but it's also a movie about the Nightmare on Elm Street franchise, and like, it's just a very layered and very interesting movie that I can't think of another franchise that has done something like this, you know, which is crazy.
Yeah, I think that it definitely, I agree that this in a way was like more ingenious than Scream, and it definitely was such a good like template for those movies. But yeah, I do like Freddy like trying to go through the kid to escape his dream world, which obviously
I think they also went out of their way to make Freddy like bulkier in this one. Like, Freddy looks big in this movie.
Yeah,
and in all the other ones, Freddy's like kind of like a skinny little dude. It's very clear that they like put like a muscle suit on Robert Englund or something. They did something to make him look like bigger and more intimidating, which was cool.
Yeah, yeah. I just wish I wish Robert playing himself was in the movie a little more though. But again, he's in the movie as Freddy, so it's like it's hard to complain about it, but I really do like the makeover that they gave him, and I think just from start to finish, watching Heather deal with all of this shit that's manifested, is fucking awesome. I really dig this movie.
Yeah, I think it's a pretty underrated movie. Like, obviously, it's well regarded, but I don't feel like people talk about it quite enough when it's like, when the like, franchise comes up, or even just when like classic 90s horror movies come up. I feel like this movie doesn't get enough recognition because it's so overshadowed by Scream.
Right. Yeah. Or overshadowed by the Elm Street movies.
Right.
It's like in between. It's in limbo.
Yeah.
No, I agree, though. It's very underrated. Speaking of the opposite of underrated, Freddy vs. Jason.
Which, I love Freddy vs. Jason.
Which this was surprisingly, from start to finish, my first time watching it. I had seen bits and pieces once years ago at a sleepover. I was way younger, but I hadn't actually watched it the whole way through, and I was like, oh my fucking god, I'm so glad I did. It's like a movie. It's
absolutely. It's this movie also has a very interesting production history that I don't know all of it ins and outs to like give an entire rundown, but like they were trying to make this movie for a very long time before it actually came out, which is this movie taking so long is why Jason X exists, because it was taking so long to, like, I guess just get all the pieces together for Freddy vs. Jason, and they wanted to put out another movie in the meantime in the Friday the 13th franchise, so they were like, all right, just do something, like, real weird, and that's why they made Jason X. Well, because it kind of doesn't really tie into the rest of the timeline.
Yeah, well, because 10 years before this movie got made, didn't they show, like, Krueger's claws at the end of that one Jason movie?
Jason Goes to Hell. Yeah, it's the end of that movie is Jason's mask like in like dirt, and Freddy's glove comes out and like grabs it and like pulls it underground. Yeah. And that movie is 93. So that was also before New Nightmare even. So it was obviously in the works for quite a long time. And then 10 years later is when Freddy vs. Jason comes out.
Yeah, which I think it was a cool little tie, and I was like, huh, that I guess that in a weird fucked up way, they're gonna make it work. They did,
and I think it's amazing. It's like one of my favorite guilty pleasure horror movies. I think it's so good. Like it captures both of the characters so well, and I think it gives you exactly what you want out of Freddy versus Jason. Like. The title of the movie is accurate. It is not one of those ones where you're like, oh, there wasn't enough action or whatever. Like, no, you are getting Freddy versus Jason in this movie 100%.
Yeah, I will say there were times I did feel like it was a parody of itself because
it absolutely is.
Because Freddy and Jason, like, they do act like themselves, but sometimes I almost wondered if they forgot halfway through the production what was really happening. Because first of all, the premise of the film is funny to me, right? But finish your thought and I'll get it.
Well, I was going to say what's interesting about the movie is they brought in a Chinese director to do this movie, which was an interesting choice. And his take on it was to do almost like a pro wrestling like type of battle. Yeah. Which is why a lot of people complain that Kane Hodder is not Jason in this movie, because he is like kind of the favorite as far as who played Jason. And the reason was that they wanted to, Kane Hodder's not that tall, and they wanted like a huge Jason for this movie to be like a like pro wrestler looking character. So it's a director who I believe this was his first English movie. So he had only done Chinese movies before. So it kind of has that like feel to it of almost like a Asian action movie kind of.
Yeah, because that's all the director like really did was like Hong Kong action films.
Yeah. And then he also would go on to direct Bride of Chucky.
I was going to say Bride of Chucky. Yeah, I didn't know that. Yeah. I just think it's so funny that like Krueger he's stuck in hell and he can't invade anyone's dreams because children have forgotten him. So he's like, you know what? I'm going to resurrect Jason Voorhees, who's canon in my world.
I think it's so great. Like, it's such a great way to bring them together.
It's so funny. And he pretends to be Jason's mother and he manipulates him into killing the kids of Springwood so that Freddy can actually return. But then Jason gets a little too kill happy and Freddy starts like getting jealous and mad, and then they battle. So what's really cool about the movie is there's not only a battle between the villains and the kids, but then there's this ongoing battle between the two villains. And they do it.
It's honestly, it's almost like a kaiju movie in many ways.
Yeah.
Yeah, like the way it's set up, the structure of it.
No, it absolutely is, and I think the kills in this one were pretty fucking cool.
Oh yeah. Obviously, there's some bad CGI in this one because it is 2003, but there's still a lot of really good stuff in this movie.
Yeah, the rave at the cornfield is great.
I love that line where the kid is like, "That's a pissed off goalie," or something like that.
Yeah, there's actually, I had a video. Hang on, I took this video when I was watching the movie because this line had me in stitches. Hang on, I have to find. Bear with me 1 second.
Yeah.
I'll
add in while you're trying to find it, which I think is funny. I always think it's funny when this happens in movies. The original actress who played Jason's mother in the original movies, they asked her to come back for this movie and she didn't want to. She thought she was like above it, I guess. I think really? After she did the Friday the 13th movie, she wasn't very like embracing of that franchise. So yeah, that's why it's a different actress playing Jason's mother in this one. They tried to get the original and she didn't want to do it.
That's very interesting. Yeah, I no thanks. I am above this.
Yeah, which again, all of those other memorable roles that she has, you know, like you know,
woman A in the movie.
Yeah, so I just thought that was kind of funny.
So this is great.
I also love the knockoff Jay and Silent Bob characters in this movie.
Oh, yeah.
Very clear.
I did find the clip, and it's the two kids in the cornfield, and he's like, "And you weren't invited," and Jason just takes his head and snaps it back. But his friend's response is just, "Son of a bitch." Like he whispers the line. He doesn't scream or anything. He's just like, "Son of a bitch." It's so fucking funny.
This movie is full camp and it does not try to fight that at all. This movie commits to the bit fully, which is what you need for a Freddy versus Jason movie.
Yeah, but it has an interesting cast. It's got Kelly Rowland as Jason Ritter. Mm-hmm. It has Lachlan Monroe as a cop, which is great. Oh, he's like baby faced. And you were saying earlier, Hypnocell comes back into this movie because they try to get it from Weston Hills. But then, oh man, one of my favorite parts is Freddy possessing that one stoner get rid of the medicine. Of course. I love that all like these. It's so funny how in the 90s and early 2000s they utilized the stoner character in like
everything. Yeah. Every horror movie has a stoner character in the 2000s.
Yeah, and I love how like him trying to Freddy like using the kid to like tranquilize Jason too, and it's such a schlock fest. I fucking love
it's
it.
Great. It's just so great. Like it's
so good.
You talk about a good party movie. This is a great party movie.
Yeah, absolutely. And I also think it's a little ridiculous how. And this ends up happening like kind of earlier in the movie where all the casts are together and they just happen to know everything about Freddy and Jason. They're like, "You mean the kid who drowned in Camp Crystal Lake?" And I'm like, how did you know? Like, there was no research done. It was like you just...
Again, it's one of those movies where it's like, if you look at it too long, like if you think too hard about it, absolutely nothing in it makes sense. Because it's like, okay, which Friday the 13th movies are canon at this point? I have no idea.
I know. I was wondering. I was like, I know there's a little bit of canon here somehow, but I don't know.
Yeah, but where it's like truthfully, which I appreciate. They're just like, you know what? Fuck it with trying to keep to an established lore. Like, people want Freddy versus Jason, here's Freddy versus Jason, and I like that.
No, of course. Yeah, I think it works to its own benefit. But and then that whole, we were mentioning earlier, like the whole construction site scene is
amazing. It's literally WWF
It battle. Is 100%, especially when Robert's like at the top of the scaffolding and he's trying to get the cement to come down and he like gets tied upside down and he's like, oh no. Jesus, just fucking whack.
It's amazing. Oh, yeah, it's so incredible. Good.
And I also think it has one of the cooler final confrontations where they're by the docks and they're trying to light them on fire and light the propane tanks. You're not sure who's gonna win because like Jason gets the upper hand, the Freddy gets the upper hand, and it's like then he fucking Jason impales Freddy with his own claws, and then Laurie beheads Freddy, and
which also another very funny addition to this when it comes to lore is that they just decide that Jason's afraid of water in this one, which makes no sense.
Oh,
like, yeah. Jason is in water for most of the franchise, and then this one they're like, Jason's scared of water.
Yeah, they were like, wait, Freddy's afraid of fire, he's gotta be afraid of water.
yeah, which again I just think is really funny.
Yeah, but yeah, I thought that was great, and then like both of them are seemingly dead. And then Jason is carrying Freddy's head, and then Freddy winks at the camera. And I thought,
which is great. Yeah,
I thought that was the perfect way to fucking end it.
Yeah,
because
apparently they
ambiguous. Yeah.
Apparently there were talks of doing Freddy versus Jason versus Ash, but I guess it just like never came to fruition. Which I don't know if that's good or bad. It could have been awesome or it could have been stupid, but it's interesting that was. Kind of at the time the idea was to tie it into Evil Dead.
Yeah, cool. I came across that and I was like,
they did do a comic. Like, they've done comics of it.
I know they did a limited series, but I was like, is that real? Like, is that fanfic? Like
I don't know how far along they got, but it was definitely a conversation at some point.
Yeah, it was just funny to me. Like I was like, "Huh, they're gonna incorporate Evil Dead. That's pretty interesting." Yeah, I guess when you're already doing Freddy vs. Jason, might as well, right?
But, yeah, bringing in Deadites is not that far fetched at that point.
Yeah, seriously. Yeah, Freddy vs. Jason, man, such a good time.
Yeah, I love it. I love everything about it. It might have been one of the first horror movies I watched when I was younger. So I love it.
Yeah, I know a lot of people, like even people I know who are not into horror, like they've seen this movie.
Yeah, this movie was a big deal when it came out. Yeah, it was a big deal because for so long people were waiting for it. Like everybody wanted Freddy versus Jason, especially after they teased it. So yeah, I remember when it came out, it was a big deal. I bet you this movie did really well in the box office too.
It did. I looked it up and it did. Like I think budget was 30 million. It did like over 100 million.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me at all.
Yeah. Well, of course, yeah. It's like the billing of that is, Jesus, talk about return on investment. Even if it was a flop, like that pairing was going to bring
people. Yeah, just the name would get people into theaters. And you know what's actually crazy about this movie? I was curious as to what other horror movies came out in 2003. And it feels like they're such different eras, but this movie came out the same year that House of a Thousand Corpses came out, which is crazy to me.
Yeah.
Right? Doesn't it feel like they did not come out around the same time?
No. That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, that, and then the other big movie that year was the Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
Which I like a lot. But yeah, same year as House of a Thousand Corpses. Weird. Imagine if Rob Zombie directed this instead. That would be insane. It might be too much.
Well, speaking of Rob Zombie, the next movie we're going to talk about is what happens when a kid is left alone and watches way too many Rob Zombie films and says, hey, I can make a slasher because, ooh, boy, this remake is bad.
It is definitely, if I had to pick, it is the worst of the 2000s. Remakes, and I think it was one of the last ones too, because it came out in 2010. That was like the tail end of the remake craze of the 2000s.
Yep. I really don't even want to discuss this, but I guess we will. I knew it was a remake, so going into it, it's like, okay, I'm gonna have an open mind. Like, it's obviously not gonna be like the series, but it was just soulless. It had nothing from anything related to Freddy. Like, it just, like,
the thing is with Nightmare on Elm Street, as soon as you don't have Robert Englund as Freddy, you've lost at least half of your audience, you know? Like, yeah. What people love about Freddy is Robert Englund. It's not the character, you know, like, he is the character. It's not like Jason where he wears a mask and you can just replace him. So I think before the movie even came out, as soon as they announced that it was not going to be Robert Englund, they lost so many people right there.
Yeah, and you know, it's kind of, at first I was like, all right, props to you know, Jackie Earle Haley, who plays Freddy in this, for like
trying, who is a good actor,
because he's, you know, he's been in horror. So I was like, okay, you know, it's, I'm sure he could like give it a decent shot. But yeah, like cutting Englund out, okay, you already lost me there. And then it's like, okay, I'll try to keep an open mind here. But the thing is like trading all of like the surrealism and the fun campy hellishness of the series for somebody who's way too grounded. Like this this felt like one of those trashy typical 2000s horror movies. Like, I felt like I could have replaced Freddy with any one of those antagonists from the 2000s, and it probably would have worked better, honestly.
Yeah. It's crazy too. The director of that movie never directed a movie before that and has not directed one since. He's only directed music videos.
I was just going to say, he's only done music videos.
Yeah. Which is bizarre. A bizarre choice. Yeah. Just a lot of bad choices going on there.
Yeah. And it's just like, there's so much. So obviously, since it's a remake, they're trying to stick to the original, and then they like have nods of the series, but it's not like beat for beat. Like, I'd say one of the only things I appreciated about the movie is like some of the nods, like Nancy being in the tub and the claws like coming out. I was like, I was like, oh, okay, like that's fun. But other than that, like, there were so many issues with this. Like, I'll just address the elephant in the room. Leaning into Freddy being a full-blown child molester does not work. That is the reason Craven, and I know people out there are like, well, that was Wes Craven's original imagination.
But not
of the
character. Really. But not He's really. A child like, murderer, not a child molester, which are two different things when it comes to a character, you know?
Yeah, both
people
both not
like
good,
Freddy.
It's the thing.
And you see as the franchise goes on how they acknowledge it less and less, you know? Like, in the first one, he's this child murderer because he's this despicable like character, but as the franchise goes on, people started to love Freddy so much that they kind of moved away from that because it was a part of him that was more like despicable, you know? So for this one to launch right back into that to the extreme again, it's like, I feel like this movie was doomed from the start.
Yeah, like, you can't this is a in memoriam for the Nightmare on Elm Street movies. this movie was doomed from the beginning, because right as soon as you made him too real of a character like that, it was gonna fail. Because like, yeah, they, if there was anything ever implied with Freddy, you know, molesting children, it was very subtle hints at it, and it was only associative, because here's the thing, it's not that it's a child killer, it's not that it's mutually exclusive that a child killer is going to also be a pedophile, but they are kind of similar in that sense. Like, it's kind of like the torture aspect, so it's like, yeah, we fucking get it, like, Freddy probably also did bad shit in addition to killing kids. But you don't have to shove it. They shove it in your throat every 5 seconds
they
of the movie.
Commit to that too much.
Yeah, it was too much, man. And like the thing is too is I understand that the movie is deep seated in the fear of trauma and confronting your past, right? Because the whole thing is that like these kids have such repressed memories from the day from the daycare or the school rather that they were at, that they don't remember who Freddy is until later in the movie, and then they come across like his secret cave that he used to take them to. I get it's rooted in your trauma, but there's so many more tasteful ways to do that. And there's been examples of it.
And if you want to make that movie, make that movie. But to take that and put it onto a character with decades worth of legacy just did not work.
Yeah. And when I was reviewing this film, I made that point. I was like, Freddy Krueger is somebody so ingrained in society as this one character who he's campy, he's sinister, there's so many things going on with him that to just throw all of that out the fucking window doesn't make sense. Like Michael Myers, for example, the only reason remakes and reimaginings can work for a character like Michael is because he's this evil, heartless bastard who doesn't speak. Like, you right. could do anything with that character. Krueger is a character. So when you're taking, like, even if you're doing a remake, like, you still have to, he's established. Like, you still have to kind of have notes of the character.
Right.
Like, and it just, it didn't exist here.
Yeah, it just they tried to take it in a direction that just did not work at all.
No, it's
and from the start was not going to work.
Yeah, and I could have maybe forgave what they did to him as a character if the teens were not insufferable. They felt like. They felt like the kids who were a couple years older than you, know when you used to go hang out at the mall on a Friday night, the kids who were a couple years older than you, wearing the trip pants, bumming cigarettes, like, they felt like kids I never want to talk to. They felt like fucking genuine assholes, and it's like, again, it's another element of edginess that they're adding to the remake. It's got to be an edgy remake. It's like, if I can't even care about your protagonist, then there's nothing working for me here.
Yeah. You
know, like, I almost feel bad that Clancy Brown was in this film.
There's a lot of good actors in it. That's the weird thing. Like, it's so obvious that the script was the failure because they have the tools to, like, make a good movie.
Yeah.
But again, at the same time, I don't know if they do have the tools to make a good movie because it's... To remake Nightmare on Elm Street, it's a huge task to take on. And
honestly,
I really don't see how you could do it successfully, honestly.
No.
I don't know if there's a way to do it right.
No, not unless you have Robert Englund.
Which is why it's just been left alone since then. Like, it was clearly a big enough failure that they haven't even tried again. And they remake everything, you know?
For sure. They knew, because this still is discussed as like one of the worst horror movies. It's like
absolutely
so fucking bad. And poor Rooney Mara. She looked like she didn't even want to be in the movie. And I don't blame her.
Yeah, I don't blame her.
It just, man, it was just so many, like, okay, like, some of the gore was cool. That's what I'll give the movie, right? It's like some of the gore was cool. The fucking why are you screaming? Freddy I didn't even cut you yet. Like, it was so, like, I felt like there were parts of the script that were like, wait a minute, dude, he's Freddy. Like, we have to throw something in there, right? Like, okay, yeah, let's make him make a fucked up joke here. Yeah, I don't know. Should we reference one of the other movies? Nah, make it a pedo joke. Like, that's literally all they did.
Yeah.
It was so uncomfortable.
Yeah, to make this movie, to make any movie and say to yourself, let's lean into the child molester aspect, is a choice.
Which again, look, here's the thing, right? I try to have an open mind with a lot in life. I get that it's a thing that's real. It's horrific. It's disgusting. It's evil. I know it's real, but you can do it so much better in a movie. You don't right. have to.
And also, it
me.
Just does not need to be in a Freddy movie.
It also, again, he's a child killer. Like, you don't need to.
You can make a horror movie that covers those themes in a more tasteful and like nuanced way. Yeah. To do it in a Nightmare on Elm Street movie is just not. I don't think it's the right choice.
No, because there's been countless examples in cinematic history where they've alluded to child killers or predators, and it's like, oh, but they don't shove it in your fucking face. It's like,
yeah,
do that. But yeah, no. But again, like, this, the thing is like, this era was so into pushing the envelope and being edgy that it's like, I get it. But you can't do it with Nightmare on Elm Street. Try it with any other franchise.
Well, look at how some of the other remakes of that era did it. I think they did it so much better. Like I said, the Texas Chainsaw remake from 2003, which was like the first one that really kicked off the 2000s remake train, did it really well. Like, they said, we're going to make it gritty and dark, and that's what this is going to be, and it's going to be gory as hell, and it works. And then, like, another one that I think works really well is The Hills Have Eyes, which is the same thing. It's they went edgy as far as grittier, darker, expanding on the themes of the original, not necessarily like adding in this new taboo stuff that was not really a part of the story. Mm-hmm. So that's what's weird with the Nightmare on Elm Street one. It's just like, all these other ones were successful kind of by exaggerating what was already there, not adding this new layer to it that's not really a part of the original, but is, I guess, considered edgy. I don't know.
Yeah, and I don't know. I just didn't like the whole, like, aside from everything else I didn't like, I just didn't like the whole, like, oh, Freddy was, like, The thing that's so stupid, right, is like, they could have made Freddy a teacher. They made him a groundskeeper. Mm-hmm. Is any adult letting their child get close to the groundskeeper? Like, I don't know. It was just like,
it's also like, just looking at it, it's such a missed opportunity too, because those other remakes, I think what they do well is they, which is what a remake should be in my head, is, okay, these are the things that, say, Texas Chainsaw Massacre wasn't able to do because of budgetary constrictions and just the limits of filmmaking at the time. They couldn't do crazy gore. They couldn't do these huge, massive, like, set pieces and slaughterhouse scenes and stuff. So let's do that. Where Nightmare on Elm Street, it's like, they could have gone all in on, like, the surreal dream aspect and, like, really pushed that and pushed the limits of what the original couldn't really do because of the time period, and they didn't go for that at all, which I think would have been a better movie.
Yeah, and that was gonna be my final biggest point, is like, you guys were just lazy. You didn't even
just drop the ball.
Like, the only thing they tried was like, okay, we'll make the floor blood. and Nancy has to wade through.
Cool. It's like, yeah, cool. It's
like, bro, you could, like you said, you could, bro, with the technology they had, even in 2010, it's like, you could have done really cool. You could have had them on, like, floating rocks, like, trying to keep their balance. Or
they should have leaned into the dream part, and they did not do that.
Yeah, like, what, like, fine, say what you will. Like, I know a remake, you take your own liberties, you do your own twist on the story, but at least make it fun.
Yeah. And look at the original and say, what aspect of this could use improving that we can do now that they couldn't do back then? And it's like, obviously the special effects is where you should go, and they just missed on that completely.
Yeah. And one of the most pitiful parts of the movies is, so there's that kid Quentin who, like, they allude early on that he's had this crush on Nancy, and throughout the film they play this stupid game of emotional chicken with each other, and then like finally towards the end he gives her a kiss, and then that's like the motivation to snap her out. And it's like, I couldn't have cared less about this.
Yeah.
It was so forced. It wasn't, it had no point being a plot point. It was like,
yeah,
oh, just for the sake of throwing in this forced romantic interest. Like, the chemistry has to be there, and it was not there. it was all stupid. And then like Nancy in the bed, and he puts the old dress back on her. I cringed at that. Like, oh, you still look good in that dress. Shut the fuck up. Like, we don't
yeah.
have to. Bro, honestly, if they just replayed the scene of the parents just like lighting him on fire, I would have been happy. They could have rolled the credits. That would have been.
Yeah.
Like,
it was just an unfortunate complete miss. And yeah. like I said, kind of the end of that period of horror remakes. Obviously, we're seeing a new era of horror remakes right now, but I feel like the 2000s horror remake trend ended with Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah.
It kind of killed it.
Yeah, they hung up Krueger's claws, and for a good reason, because mm-hmm. I mean, unless, and even if like, and my final question was going to be like, what do we think the future could be? Because to me, even if you have England come back, which I'm sure, I mean, England is very heavily still involved in Nightmare affiliated yeah. communities. Like, he does sponsorships with clothing companies to do mm-hmm. merch and all this.
He does horror cons a lot.
He does horror cons. So he very much like would probably sign up to do another one. But even if mm-hmm. you have him, it's like, who are we really going to get in this day and age that's not Craven that could kill it?
Like, yeah, that's why it's just, I'm glad they're leaving it alone. Unfortunately, I'm sure that won't last forever because everything has to come back. But right now it's like, just leave it alone.
Yeah. Well, because I know
I can't think of how they could do it.
Yeah, I know they were talking about doing a reboot for a long time, but mm-hmm. I don't even know what that would fucking entail at this point.
Yeah, I have no idea.
The only way this would work is if they found within Wes Craven's vault in his house that he had a finished script for a final Nightmare on Elm Street movie.
Yeah.
And Robert Englund agreed to come back, and Heather Langenkamp. What was it?
Yeah.
Like, it's the only way it's working. Otherwise, it's mm-hmm. not working.
Yeah, which is why I think it's just better off being left alone. Wes yeah. Craven's gone, unfortunately. Robert Englund's not young either, so it's like, man, there's only so much longer that we could really even do it, that it's like, just leave it alone.
Yeah, I mean, look, hope. we got nine films?
Yeah.
Well, I don't want to count the remake. So we have 8 films that have Freddy. And oh yeah, and there's also like that mini television series, which I haven't watched. But
I haven't watched it either. I don't know much about it.
But I know, like, Freddy's Nightmare is also in it. Yeah. So
yeah, but I don't know much about it. It's not easy to find.
Yeah. But I think that the fact we got 8 good movies, or at least mostly good movies.
Yeah,
I'm cool with that. You know, that's cool. I'm happy.
It's the same with Friday the 13th. Like, obviously, Friday the 13th, the only reason they're not making more is because of the legal battles going on. But God, it's like, I don't find myself craving another Friday movie. I don't find myself craving another Nightmare on Elm Street movie.
Yeah, because they did what they set out to do. And I'm sure down the line, like you said, they will reboot them. But like,
absolutely,
at least for now, we can sit in solace knowing that we got what we got, and we could talk about them fondly.
So, yeah,
because if they did several more movies like this remake, I'd probably beg Freddy to come into my dreams.
Kill me.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm glad though I got to sit from start to finish and watch these, because these have been on my list for a long time. Yeah,
it's such a fun franchise.
Yeah, I'm itching to rewatch some of these already, and I just saw them. So it's like, I'm down. But yeah,
I definitely am in the mood to rewatch Freddy vs. Jason now.
Yeah,
just right. Love that movie.
Yeah, that it's man, Krueger, like I said, is just one of the coolest characters in horror. And Craven obviously was one of the biggest geniuses, and so it's no surprise it was a success. Fuck yeah. But yeah, I think that's probably going to wrap it up here, if you had any closing thoughts.
Nope, yeah. I got nothing. I'm all Freddied out.
I'm all Freddied out. Join us in a week where we do a deep dive into the Critters series.
Leonardo DiCaprio's first role is Critters 3, I think.
Yeah, I actually have the box set from, I think it's Scream Factory?
Mm-hmm. I don't know if I've ever seen past the first Critters movie.
Yeah, I've only seen the first one, but I had fun with it. It was fun. Yeah. But yeah, that's going to wrap it up here for our entire dive into the Nightmare on Elm Street series. And hopefully we leave it at that for now. But yeah.
Please.
But this has been the Silver Scream Fiends podcast. I've been Sam.
I've been Blake.
And one, two, Freddy, come. I'm going to work on a trap remix of the Freddy song.
Hell yeah. That definitely exists. It has to.
It 100% does. And it's going to
be. Have you ever heard the Will Smith, the rap song, The Nightmare on My Street by Will Smith?
No.
If not, you have to listen to it. He did a Nightmare on Elm Street song in the 80s, as the Fresh Prince, and it's incredible.
Well, I know what the ending song of this episode's going to be.
It is the best.
Yeah, god fucking damn it. Why did it have to be Will Smith? Yeah, that is great. I will check it out though. But yeah, join us next time as we will. Oh yeah, we're gonna be entering Noirvember soon.
Mm-hmm, that's always fun.
Oh fuck yeah. Yeah, I'm excited for that. But yeah, this has been a nice spooky season. I've indulged in quite a bit, and I've been frantically searching for things to clean my palate from that fucking awful remake. So
yeah, I gotta watch Barbarian, just came out on HBO.
Yes, yes, my
I'm
friend
dying to
hit,
see that.
My friend just hit me up and said we should watch it because it's on HBO.
I happened to like just miss the theatrical run because I just like wasn't able to go see it, so I'm excited to watch it.
Same here. But until then, have a spooky day.
Toodaloo.